Welcome to Innovation Oxford. You know, time was that it was an easy thing to look after a lawn at your house, but when we stopped using pesticides, it became quite a challenge. But now we're going to take a look at a firm that is meeting that challenge in the lawn care business here in Woodstock. We're here with Jordan Lavin, who's responsible for Nutri-Lawn. He grew up here in Woodstock. We know that there was big question about the use of pesticides on lawns, but Jordan, sounds like the technology has caught up with the need.
Yeah, we've come a long ways in the innovation on the technology side of the way we deliver service, but also on the products that we use to care for lawns. And it's allowed us to think differently about the business and come up with a lot of new innovative ways to treat lawns and take old practice and turn it into new technology.
And you've got an app. I hear there's an app for everything. Now there's an app for my lawn?
Yeah, we've built a web-based app that our technicians use to do what we call our lawn evaluation process. So it's like a 40-point inspection that the technicians do. They'll examine the lawn. We'll do an example here today where the guys will go through and find out what's going on under the ground within the soil. We'll find out what kind of weeds you have. We'll find out what type of grass you have, all the growing conditions that we have to work with through the course of the year. And the findings on that app will drive how we treat your lawn and how we communicate with you and what we educate you on as far as what you have here that we're going to do.
Sounds like it's more than just cutting the grass and watering it.
It is. It's from our side, we sort of built this application with the premise of, if you were to go and switch doctors tomorrow, what would be the first thing they would do? They would do a full evaluation. They'd check all your vitals, and that's exactly what we're going to do today with our app.
You brought a team of people along with you. Why don't you introduce us?
We brought Ben's going to show us some of the application processes that we do, and Sean Karn is our agrologist and agrologist, and Sean's a double turf major with Penn State backing him today, but he's going to walk us through all the tech side of what happens on the lawn. And Sean is the technical director behind this app and helped develop all the bits and bytes that go into it.
Sean, it looks like you've got an MBA in turf.
Yes.
Is that what it takes today to really know what's going on under the earth?
Well, there's a lot going on in the lawns, and like you said, it's more than just watering and mowing. So, you know, we got to take a closer look at what's happening, like as Jordan said, in the soil, in the grass, find the insects, the diseases, all the weeds. So, yeah, there's a lot.
Well, you know, I'm ready for a good close look at this lawn, you know, because I think when we get to know it, we're not going to like what's here.
Yes. You've definitely got a few things going on here.
What's going on here?
So this fertilizer that we're using is the most efficient fertilizer. It has the least amount of leaching possible. This is the new technology. So this is straight urea.
What is urea when it comes to fertilizer?
Urea is the base for the nitrogen. Right?
Oh, okay.
So it's the coating that has all the value. The way that the coating works and the release ability of the coating is what makes this the most efficient.
You're saying that every little fertilizer bead has got a coating on it.
Yeah, and that coating is made up of two different polymers that are blended together.
A polymer is like a plastic?
Sure, and one of them is based off of moisture, and the other one's based off of temperature. So the coating will actually open and crack and release the urea, release the nutrients based on both the moisture and the temperature. So if we get a cold spring like we're having this year, then that fertilizer will just close back up and it won't release because the plant doesn't need it. And then when the temperature warms up, it will open back up again and start to release. And then if we go into another cold spell, it'll close itself back up again.
So all of this is going on in your lawn with or without your knowledge.
Exactly.
Is that what I'm hearing?
Exactly. And this sort of shows the graph over time for today. So this is the polygraph that runs starting today. If we do the application, you'll see on May 7th, 2014, which is today. So if we do the application today, this shows the release period of 1.5 pounds of product put down over the course of, you know, the weeks across the bottom here. So this shows how it will release.
Now, you mentioned the least amount of leaching. Leaching was a consideration, wasn't it, about pesticides and other kinds of treatments going into the watershed. You're saying that this has been greatly reduced?
Absolutely. I mean, this product is, you know, that's one of the reasons why it's the most efficient product, because of that way that coating closes back up and opens back up based on temperature and based on moisture, it's the most efficient release.
So what is it you see here on this lawn? What is it you're seeing?
Well, there's a lot of different things going on here. It's still early in the spring, so the lawn hasn't truly come out of its dormancy, but you've got predominantly a lot of moss in this situation.
And moss being here is a sign of what?
Well, it could be a number of factors, but you've got some large mature trees that have a lot of shade, and usually you see moss where there's heavy shade conditions where it's really hard for the turf to grow. So you've got, that's what's going on here. As well as a lot of weeds coming through here. You can
see a lot of weeds?
A lot of weeds. And the grass that is here, it's a specific species called fine fescue that grows well in shade, but it's not aggressive enough to outcompete the moss. So even though you see a little bit here, it's still predominantly moss.
So this grass is the fine fescue, is that what
yeah.
you said?
Yeah? Yes, yes.
So it was here when we bought the house?
It could have been, or over the years it's become the dominant species to take over this condition. So
how does it happen that we've got like grass patches here and moss over there and then maybe nothing? I mean, how would you describe the circumstances of this lawn besides pitiful?
Yeah,
there's
a lot of uniformity issues. It's predominantly where the grass is coming in, fine fescues growing here, other areas, moss, dandelions, clover, henbit. There's lots going on here.
It's pretty exciting to have all this diversity on this lawn.
Sure, if you want to call it that.
This is where your app comes in that sort of guides your evaluation.
Yeah, the first part that we try to capture is your lawn size, and kind of a cool feature that we have at the end of the evaluation report, it calculates what your oxygen output for your lawn is based on your square footage.
Is that important?
Well, it's a neat feature. A lot of people like to think of trees as the main way that, you know, the main benefit that trees
right.
give is for oxygen.
Yeah.
But the lawn provides mm-hmm. just as much benefit for oxygen. Carbon offset feature, so again, we're calculating that, and the cooling effect that your lawn produces.
And stay with us. Okay, so what's the first step here in lawn evaluation?
So the first step that we do is, after we've got all your information into the system, we usually start with a picture of the actual property. So we try to get a little bit of the turf in the picture and the house. And
just a little bit of this turf?
Just a little bit. We don't want too much here.
We don't want to frighten too many people.
Exactly. And that becomes the cover page for the evaluation report.
Where are we in the app?
So we're at the very beginning here. So we've got you'd marked down here for 7,500 square feet. That's your lawn size. So the second portion here is we try to capture some special notes about your property. If you've got excessive shade, which you've got some large mature trees, so we'll mark that off. Do you have an irrigation system, landscape lighting?
Only that which God provides.
Okay. What about pets?
We have a dog, but a dog doesn't get out here.
Okay. Looks like you got some tree root issues. So this is just, like I said, a little special note section. So we've got kind of marked off what's pertinent to your property.
Mm-hmm.
So the next section we're going to go in is to identify the different types of turf grass that is in the lawn. So,
can you find any turf grass in this lawn? We
there
have
is,
little clumps of it.
There's little clumps of it. So what we're going to mark down here is that you've got fine fescue.
Okay.
So we'll mark that down.
That's a good thing, right?
Yes, okay. yes. Because
at least we got some grass.
The next section is the density of the turf. So this is basically going to tell us, you know, how thick and lush the lawn is.
Lush, I love that word, thick and lush.
So
a term you wouldn't use here, right?
No, our top selection is very thick and dense, and our bottom selection is weed infested and bare.
So we got an F on this lawn?
Maybe we'll go weed infested and bare.
Sounds serious.
Yes. Okay, so after we've identified the turf grass density and the turf grass species, we go into your thatch layer.
Okay, so what section are we in now?
So the thatch. So what we use here is we use a special soil probe to actually probe your lawn, and we'll take a core sample and we'll be able to determine if you've got excessive thatch, which is very undesirable, or no thatch or a thin layer, or it could be acceptable or thick layer. So based on these findings,
yeah.
it'll spit out a disposition that gives you recommendations.
Okay, so we've done our probe, and what did we determine?
In your case, you've got a lot of bare spots, thin areas, so we're going to go thin layer here. It doesn't seem like thatch is a big problem.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll select thin layer. So the next section is our soils, and this is where we're going to measure our soil pH. And
pH is?
That's the measure of acidity or alkalinity of your soil.
Okay.
So in Ontario, optimal range, and for turf grass, is usually 6.5 to 7.5. So when it's below that, we kind of call it acidic. If it's above it, we call it alkaline.
We will be right back. Well, we're back again. It's 3 weeks since the last time we were here, and it's clear that they've been doing something to this lawn, a term I use creatively. Jordan, what's been done in the intervening 3 weeks?
So since we were here last time, the fertilizer's had a chance to release. We've got some warmer temperatures, and we've got the fertilizer kicking in. We were by just to touch up some of the hard-to-control weeds, the creeping Charlie and the wild violet and stuff like that, to give us allowance for the new seed to come through. And today we're going to slit seed. We're going to get new turf established in here. We're going to plant the seed, and we're going to get some of these thin and weed-ridden areas under control. And
isn't that most of the lawn?
It is most of the lawn, so we're going to end up seeding most of the lawn.
Are you still hopeful you can turn this into a lawn?
Oh, not, it's not hope, it's promise.
Is it? Oh, you're making a promise to us.
Oh, yeah.
And I see you brought this very interesting machine. Why did you actually use this machine? Why do you use this?
This machine is a slit seeder. So what it's doing is it cuts grooves into the grass, into the turf, and it plants the seed right into the ground. So as opposed to spreading and having to till or any of the other practices that people would try to get grass seed to germinate.
So Jordan, I would go to the seed store, buy some seed, and throw it on the ground.
And feed the birds with it. Or you would slit seed it, cut grooves into the ground, and plant the seed at its optimal depth and allow it to have good seed soil contact, which is what it needs for germination.
And you brought your crew along. Does it take really two guys and you to actually do this, Joe?
More the two guys. But yeah,
you supervise.
Yeah, it takes the two of them to do the job properly.
Show us how. You know what? We're going to be back here in a couple of weeks, you know, to start really taking this lawn seriously. It's going to be fiesta time, so bring your sombrero. A month's gone by. We've been watering religiously every day. But you know what? I think that this lawn is challenging every bit of technology and innovation that this firm has. I was expecting a fiesta. I almost brought my sombrero. But tell me, what is fiesta and why do you use it?
Fiesta is chelated iron. It controls weeds. It's a selective herbicide, so we can spray it on the turf and it won't damage the turf, but it kills the weeds.
What kind of weeds, by the way, they're everywhere. What kind of weed were you specifically looking for?
You've got a little bit of everything here, so we've found lots of specimens. We could probably teach a course on this lawn, but we found some wild strawberry. There's lots of plantain, some clover patches, lots of dandelion. There's just about everything here that you can throw at us.
Are you still optimistic we can bring this lawn back from the dead?
Yeah, it's starting to look good. We got some of the seed coming up from our slit seeding application. The fertilizer is kicked in. You can see some of the boulevard stuff starting to thicken up. And once we get some of these weeds out of here and allow that turf to thicken, it's going to go.
But you're being challenged by something that we've seen here. That is the moss seems to be preventing.
Some of these patches where we've got heavy moss are preventing the seed from coming up through. It's slowing it down. It's not preventing it. It'll come. It's just going to take a little extra time. We're going to hit it today with the iron today and get rid of some of that moss and allow that seed to pop through there.
So Jordan, a few years back, pesticides were banned, particularly 2,4-D, which was good for broadleaf weeds, but you've come up now with something, an alternative.
Yeah, shortly after the banning of traditional herbicides, chelated iron came to the market, Fiesta, brought to Canada by a German company, and good timing. We were able to sort of insert that product right when the need was re-ramping up after traditional herbicides had been removed as a tool.
How does it compare in price? 2,4-D was common and
yeah.
I think probably very low priced. Yeah. What's the difference?
Yeah, in hindsight, 2,4-D was very reasonably priced and very effective. Fiesta, exponentially more, And the way we apply it has to be completely re-engineered as to how we used to do business. Spot treat applications, repeat applications on certain weeds, they have to be hit a couple times within a certain time frame window to be able to get effective control.
And what's the word chelated mean?
So chelation is the process of allowing the iron to be water soluble for uptake by the plant.
All right, that's pretty simple, right?
Yeah.
Time was in this city that we were going to have to name our city flower to be the dandelion. There are people out there that thought that when the pesticide was banned, you couldn't do anything about it, but I think you can.
Yeah, we absolutely get, we get great weed control, dandelion control, thistle control. There's a lot of weeds that we don't have any challenges with now that we've got the use of Fiesta and chelated iron. Does a great job. Different in how we apply it and different methodology to how we used to do business 10 years ago and beyond. But we get absolutely great control, and nobody needs to be in the mindset that they can't get weed control anymore.
Well, we're going to need it here, aren't we?
Yeah, we are. So this is plantain. Plantain's a good example of an easier to control weed with Fiesta. You'll see the blackening here. Uh-huh. So this was applied last week, and you'll see that there's lots of destruction happening on the leaf surfaces of the plantain. So both narrow leaf and broadleaf plantain take to Fiesta quite well.
Where's the strawberries? If we were to let the strawberries go, would we actually be able to harvest strawberries on this lawn?
Yeah, there's quite a patch over here of wild strawberry that you've got going, which is a tough to control weed. Not unlike Creeping Charlie, it's got a waxy surface to it, which makes it tough to penetrate. It takes a few applications to get rid of it. We can control it. You can see the Fiesta turning it black. That's the main difference between products of days gone by. It used to cause the plant to twist and curl. Fiesta actually turns it black, and you'll get that blackening within 24 hours usually. You could put little signs. You could run some high school science classes through here. You got patches of plantain. You'll see a couple spots over here where we did some sample applications, and this is kind of what it does to the plantain. It causes that blackening, which takes place very quickly.
Now Fiesta is organic. And is a residual in the soil?
Fiesta is it's natural. It's sourced from iron. It has no ability to control future weeds. It's a contact herbicide.
And so here, speaking of contact, what's this?
You've got a patch of plantain here. This is all plantain in here. You've got some black medic. There's lots of clover.
Black medic.
Yeah, black medic's got that little yellow flower on it. There's a couple of patches over here, there was a little yellow flower on it.
And here is this black medic as well?
There is a little black medic in there, yep. Yeah, there you go.
Stay tuned. We're going to have more with Nutri-Lawn in 90 seconds.
We're here for the final report card on our lawn from Jordan Lavin, a Nutri-Lawn. Jordan, how are we doing?
We're doing pretty good. We've since the season started, we've put about 3 months into this lawn. We've fertilized, we've aerated, top dressed. We got lots of grass seed into this, and we've attacked the weeds quite well. So, you know, the next step from this point forward is we've got a little bit more weed control to do this season and a fall fertilizer. But today I'd like to hand you over the keys to your new lawn. And we're going to talk about aftercare and what your responsibilities are from this point forward to make sure this lawn continues to grow thick.
Where do I put these keys in the lawn?
I'm sure this is just a little prop here, kind of a fun gag, because you've done a lot of work. Certainly this lawn was let go. We never watered it. We never did anything to it. And it showed. And it was an opportunity for every weed in the city and everything that shouldn't be here to be here. So you're going to give us some tips on how to maintain this?
We're going to talk about aftercare and specifically mowing and watering, which are the two requirements that you're going to take on from this point forward.
Do I have to do the mowing? And I thought my wife did that.
Well, maybe. Yeah.
It's a family tradition. Yeah. If she's watching, turn away. Let's go take a look at parts of the lawn. Some tips about mowing and the height of grass. What do you think is
first thing we want to talk about is the height of mow. So ideal height is between 2.5 and 3 inches. Okay. So uh-huh. Let's take a look and let's see where you're at right now.
Okay.
So we've got, if we take a look here, you know, your height is currently sitting at about 5 inches. So ideally we want 2.5 to 3 inches. That's going to give you a nice, thick, robust turf, it's going to allow for deep roots, which is going to bring moisture up in drier conditions.
Is it true that the more often you mow, that you get a better root structure?
Absolutely. And the other thing that you want to talk about is when you mow, you don't want to take more than a third of the leaf blade at once. So you don't want to let it grow to 6 inches, then cut it back to 3. You want to let it grow to 3 1/4 or 3 1/2 tops and bring it back to 3. Take the half inch.
And by doing that, you'll get a better root structure and a better looking lawn.
You'll get a very thick stand of turf, which is going to resist weeds. We've still got a few weeds in here because we still have some bare soil. As that turf thickens up, you're going to prevent any future weeds from coming in. The only other thing to talk about is watering.
Yeah, you know, when we certainly watered a lot when the seed was down, when the fertilizer was down, and our watering consumption was triple what it normally was. Of course, we were not watering this lawn. So would you say that this year there was enough moisture coming down, much rain, that we wouldn't have had to water so much, often?
On an existing lawn, this would be a good year where you probably didn't have to do any watering at all. There's been ample moisture. I mean, when growing new seed, you need to supplement the water that comes. You know, we did have a few dry weeks right after the seeding, but this is a year where you probably could get away without watering. You can allow turf to go dormant in the summer for a period of time and bring it back in the fall without permanent damage, but 1 inch per water or one inch per week of water is more than adequate to maintain a decent lawn.
Now, there are three kinds of grass seed that were put here, weren't there? What are those three?
We put down a blend of Kentucky bluegrass, we put some fescues, and we put some ryegrass in, so it's a triple play blend.
Why the three varieties?
You know, each one of the different varieties has different characteristics and attributes that provide quality. The ryegrass comes up nice and quick to provide some cover. The bluegrass, the Kentucky bluegrass, gives you that nice blue-green color. And the fescues, in your condition, are great for the shade.
And so if someone's thinking about looking after their lawn, they have to really do a diagnosis in terms of what kind of grass to put where.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. It can play a big role for sure. And there's lots of new varieties of grass seed out there, eco grass and stuff like that, that requires less moisture. So a little bit of research before you decide exactly what you're going to do will help you in the long run.
So I guess you're not going to let us just leave this stuff alone here, right?
No, we're going to be.
You're going to drive by and checking up on us?
We've got secret cameras installed to make sure that you mow.
Well, we'll mow, that's right, yeah, but watering or whatever, what's the future hold for us?
I think you got a pretty thick stand of turf coming along here. You know, this fall looks pretty good. I think, you know, the other key in this property with lots of leaves here is to make sure you get the leaves off in a timely fashion so it doesn't smother the grass this fall.
Well, that's true. 1 year I didn't do it fast enough. They got frozen to the ground, and in the spring we had to take a shovel and shovel them off. Yeah, they're a crop on this street. You know, we have a fixation about our lawns, I know that. And sometimes you regret the effort that it takes to keep them in prime condition, but there is a side effect, and that is the oxygen that they give off, the carbon dioxide that they remove just like our trees, and of course the cooling effect that these lawns have on our homes, particularly where there are no trees. Thanks for sticking with us over these many weeks to see how this lawn is going to be coming back to life. We got a little more work to do in the fall, but for Innovation Oxford, I'm your host Mike Harding, and we'll see you next time.